Hello and welcome to another episode of 5 Games 5 Minutes from acornelectron.co.uk. Holdout is one of those games where expectations meet reality. It was marketed in a similar way to Elite, in a big glossy box with a map of courses, a thick manual, and an array of gorgeous looking screenshots plastered everywhere the Electron owner cared to look. The trouble is, golf itself. You might be familiar with such basic golf games on the Electron from its early days. Choose a direction, choose your strength, hit the ball, blah blah. Golf nuts might be in their element, but us normal people find this sort of playability very tedious. And that's the trouble with Holdout. Underneath all its glitz, it's the same tedious game of many a basic typing. Worse still, the graphics take an absolute age to build up on screen, and whilst you're actually playing it, it keeps pausing for long periods while it does a load of computations. Somewhat amusingly, you can even see all the data being shuffled around in memory at the very top of the screen. Honestly. In paused screenshots, Holdout does look good. Mind you, so does Dragon's Lair. Get the idea? This is Polar Perils, a clash of man versus beast in the icy flows of the tundra. It's a diabolical game. A litany of boredom and frustration, in which you must jump from one patch of floating ice to another. You need to get from the top to the bottom of the screen, picking up one of the two spears en route. The thing is that all of these ice patches move completely at random, so it's stupid. Hardly any skill is needed, it's all luck. And sometimes you need the luck of the devil himself to even get on an ice patch, let alone get anywhere near the spear or the goal. Most of the time you just end up stranded, watching your time tick down until either it expires or the beast pounces on you. This is dross. I mean, this is even worse than Alternative's License to Kill. It actually deserves a bit more recognition for its awfulness than it currently has. There are just so many ways to be killed through absolutely no fault of your own. And that the die is cast from the very second you start to play guarantees you will end up weeping with frustration. Pure and simple garbage. Welcome to PSYCASTRIA, a blasting game from the author of Sphere of Destiny, Synchron and Ultron, Mr. Gary Partis. All of his games are hard. Okay, this one's not so hard as to be completely unplayable, but it's hard enough that most of you are going to give up without having completed Mission 1. What you have to do is destroy the 10 blue circular things. They're somewhere in the alien base spread out underneath you. After you've destroyed them, you have to land on the landing strip, and you view the whole game from overhead. You can change direction, but the momentum of your craft is such that it reverses direction by turning through 180 degrees. This is a problem in a base where big tall buildings stick up out of the ground. Inevitably you're going to smash into them if you're not careful. There are quite a few problems with PSYCASTRIA. Obviously it's hard, but it's also fast and it's difficult to see your flickery spacecraft against the scrolling green background. It's also cramped too. The circular pods are tucked away between buildings and scenery, and hitting them calls for some serious acrobatic skill and dexterity. It's quite attractive to look at, but too difficult to really be considered fun. Sorry. Serpent's Lair is a text adventure for children from the not-so-very-well-known Comsoft. It's set on the planet Earth, and it equips you with a magic carpet, meaning you can travel huge distances with the usual north, south, east and west commands. Some locations are illustrated, albeit not very well, and the text changes colour. There are a range of problems to solve, and the game claims to be educational. Indeed, Comsoft suggests that you play with an atlas alongside you, as the locations are arranged in a manner which is geographically correct. However, even if you're at the suggested age range of 7 to 12, all you have to do is to collect object X and bring it to character Y. Hardly rocket science. The game is also incredibly small, meaning it won't take a child very long at all to solve it. I think most children would prefer something with a lot more meat, something like, Twin Kingdom Valley? which is fortunate really, because back in the day, Serpent's Lair sold in incredibly small numbers, and is almost impossible to find now. Thomas the Tank Engine was around when I was a boy, and he's still puffing along today. Although, that's certainly not on the strength of Thomas's Fun with Words, an educational game which, frankly, I can't see any point in whatsoever. Firstly, this is aimed at very young children, pre-nursery school in fact. Secondly, it only teaches about 10 words. Yes, that's right, 10. So the cynic might say 1 minute per word gives you a game that's good for about 10 minutes. Now I know young children will happily play the same thing for hours, but even they are going to get bored typing words like ear, car and boy ad infinitum. What's worse is that this is a big suite of programs, 6 of them in fact, but they all use the same words. Talk about a missed opportunity. Okay, I'll admit that the graphics are nice, but as for the games, well, this is like buying a one-way ticket to Boredom City.